Wow. I think it'd be good right now if we would just pray to the God in heaven right now. Lord, that was absolutely amazing to hear all of these voices in this room singing that out loud. It gave me chills. It was so delightful to my soul, and I could only imagine how much more delightful it was to your soul, to your spirit, to your heart. Thank you, God, that you're in the midst of us today. We need you. We pray that you would continue to arrest our hearts and woo us into this relationship that you so desperately want with us, Lord. Thank you. We love you. We bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Let the worship team know how much you love that. Go ahead. Let them know. Come on. Yeah. Oh, wow. Hey, we're so grateful that you've chosen to be with us today and present. And we are just enjoying being with each other. Thank you so much. And I'm grateful to God. It's so great that it seems like, you know, over the months, more and more people are beginning to get a little more comfortable to come and to be with us and to gather together in this room. So thank you so much for coming. And we're also very grateful for all of you that have chosen to connect with us and be with us online. You are deeply appreciated just as much. So you'll find that in this church are a bunch of people that love Jesus and love each other. And that makes this a wonderful place to be. And for those of you who are still distancing yourself just in a smart way because of COVID, and you're home either listening to this live or you're catching it a little bit later, we completely understand your desire and your need to, you know, be safe. And we just want to say we cannot wait, though, for when you will be with us face-to-face again, because we want to hug your neck. Amen. We want to hug your neck, yeah. So I was preparing the message this week, and when I was reminded of this story about these two little snotty-nosed little boys. They're about 6 years old, and they were back in the kids program at church, and they're just being, I mean, just crazy boys, just out of their stinking minds. They got a little girl, and they're playing tug-of-war with her pigtails, and they had gotten some worms and frogs, and they put some worms in the Kool-Aid in the classroom, and then they took a frog and put it in a little girl's dress, and the teacher had enough. She's out of her mind. She's going crazy. She said, I cannot handle this anymore. So she grabs those boys by the ears, drags them to the pastor's office, knocks on the door. He comes out. She goes, they're your problem now. She goes off. Now he's standing there looking at the boys, and it wasn't the first time they'd been in his office. And he's thinking, you know what? These boys need the Lord. That's what they need. They need Jesus. That's exactly what these boys need. So he told one of the little boys, he said, little boy, you stay out here in the hallway. You're next. He said, you come with me. Went into his office. He set that little boy down in a chair. He went on the other side of his big ominous desk. He sat in the chair, and he just stared at that boy in the eyes. And he knew he needed the Lord. So he looked at this boy, and he goes, where is God? Little boys are staring at him back. Then he got a little louder. Where is God? Little boy got a little nervous. He's like, oh. And then the pastor raised his hand in the air, banged his desk. He said, where is God? At that little boy jumped up out of that seat, made a beeline out of that office, ran right past his friend who yelled at him. He goes, how did it go? The little boy's running. He said, not good. God is missing, and they're trying to blame it on us. Little bitty kids, man. That's so funny. Hey, here's the reality. Based on what I experienced today with the koinonia, good fellowship, hanging out with each other, the worship, man, here's the truth. God is not missing. Amen. He is alive and well on planet Earth, and he is alive and well at Oak Leaf Church. Amen. And it was so good to see everyone this morning. And, you know, but there is this little with one caveat type deal. He's not missing, but sometimes, by the way that we live our lives, not including him on all of our decisions, it might appear that he is missing. Those moments when we kind of step up and we decide that we're going to be the God of our own life, and then it is like, where is the real God? I mean, what's going on? He appears to be missing out of our lives because we're keeping him kind of at bay because we like to kind of control our own lives and make our own decisions, and it's as if God is missing. And in light of that, we're in our 14th segment of our series, New Norm. And this morning, James is going to speak to our hearts, and what he's going to do is he is going to shake our plans, he is going to rattle our cage, and he's going to roll right over our poor attempts to be the own God of our own lives, and he's going to do this and shake us up because he wants us to come to this place of a new norm when we experience God at the center of everything. Amen. So I'm going to read from the infallible, inerrant, inspired, authoritative Word of God. Would love to have you guys follow along with me in James chapter 4, verses 13 through 17. This is the second part of one message that we are doing in the middle of this series called New Norm. And this little segment is called Playing God. Last week we dealt with playing God over other people's lives. Today we're dealing with playing God over our own lives. And listen to what James, the half-brother of Jesus, says. In James chapter 4, 13 through 17. Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a city and spend a year there and engage in business and make a profit. Yet you do not know what your life will be like tomorrow. You're just a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and also do this or that. But as it is, you boast in your arrogance, and all such boasting is evil. Therefore, to one who knows the right thing to do and does not do it, to him it is sin. I told you he was going to do some shake, rattle, and rolling, didn't I? Man, that's some pretty hard words right there. Now, I want you to note something, though, that there's nothing inherently wrong with these activities. You can kind of rest a little bit. Planning ahead isn't a bad thing. There's nothing evil about setting a schedule. There's nothing negative about engaging in business. And there's nothing sinful about making a profit. God's word is clear about that. Let me give you a couple of instances. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 9. In the message, I love the way Eugene Peterson put it. He said, slack habits and sloppy work are as bad as vandalism. That's pretty clear, isn't it? You know what that means? God frowns upon sloppiness and slackness. He likes for there to be order and productivity. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 14 through 16. Wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Be very careful then how you to live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. What does that tell us? God is for structure and productivity. And it doesn't get any more clear than Matthew chapter 25, verses 14 through 30. That's the parable of the talents. You remember that story, right? There's a master, and he gives his servants some money, and then the master goes away, and then he returns, and he evaluates all of his servants. And what does he do? He gives a major blessing to the servant that actually made a profit. So listen, the Bible is absolutely clear. There's nothing biblically wrong in doing any of these things. Here's the problem. Lean into this. The problem is doing these things without considering God and his will in any of it. That is not a winning strategy for the believer, nor is it a winning strategy for anyone else on this planet, especially when it comes to eternity. You know what James is saying in these verses? Essentially, he's saying this. Imagine yourself as the final authority over your life. In other words, imagine yourself to be God. For some of you wives, you can look at your husband and say, you're going to have to use a lot of imagination, amen. You're going to imagine yourself as the final authority over your life, that you're God, and then go ahead and live like it. Take God, the true God, completely out of the picture. Don't depend on him. Don't even recognize his existence. James kind of makes this point, because he lays out for us five things and five ways that we are prone to be the God over our own lives. I want you to follow along with me as I read these to you. He lists five things that we are prone to play God over in our own lives. First, God of our days. Remember he said, you go today or tomorrow. God of our days. God of our destination. We'll go to such and such a place. God of our duration. We're going to spend the year there. God of our duties, and we're going to engage in business. And then God of our dollars, and we're going to make a profit. And the idea is we're going to make money that's for us and us alone. It's our profit. Now, that may have been the norm before you surrendered your life to Jesus Christ as the Lord of your life, before you surrendered to Jesus as the master teacher of your life to whom we are his apprentices. That might have been the norm then. But now, James is saying that the new norm is diametrically different. And so to understand these things that he's teaching us in these verses that I read, we're going to really explore two central thoughts. First, the problem that we face. We got a problem. Turn to the person next to you and say, we got a problem. We got a problem. There's a problem that we face. And then the second thought is the plan that we should follow. So that's pretty simple, isn't it? The problem that we face and the plan that we should follow. First, the problem that we face. There's two levels to this. The problem we face is this. We have limited lens. We have a limited lens, the way we see things, and we have a limited life. We have a limited lens. As mere mortal humans, we have no idea what the future will bring. Now, we predict the weather, but oftentimes we even get that wrong. Well, not us, but the meteorologist, he gets it wrong. See, we have no magic crystal ball to foresee the future, do we? And the reality is one rude intrusion of an unexpected event could put an end to all our plans. I don't think there's any greater illustration for that than our own very lives right here in 2020. COVID-19 was on nobody's radar, and yet it moved in. And I can't help but think, because of the way that our world, especially America, that says, in God we trust, right? But we become our own gods. I can't help but think that God allowed this COVID thing to happen in the year 2020. 2020. Optometrists call 2020 really good eyesight. Could it be that God allowed it to happen in 2020 because he wanted to arrest our attention at our short-sightedness of going life alone? Get the picture. See it, because you know what? You and I have limited lens, and we should thank God that we got a God that wants us to see the big picture. Think about 9/11. 9/11, the name of the very day is based upon the date on which it fell, 9/11. But isn't it intriguing to you that those little numbers are also numbers that we associate with calling out for help, 911? Now, most people would say, oh, that's just a coincidence, because they just see things through eyes of fate. But for those of us that see through eyes of faith, we have to believe that the God of the universe is involved in the intriguing little tiny details. Amen? Details that we can't foresee because we are humans with a limited lens. That's our problem. We cannot foresee the future. But we got a God who can. Amen? But if that's not just the biggest problem, though. I think the biggest problem is the second thing. We had a limited life. We got a limited life. Think about this. Playing God with our own lives is risky because we have no assurance of a long one. Hold on. You want me to amen myself real quick? we don't have no assurance of a long life. We don't. James calls our lives in this earthly space-time continuum a vapor. He calls our life in these verses a vapor. What in the world is he talking about when he says our life is a vapor? Might I ask my sweet joy to cue the lights? What is a vapor? Now you see it, now you don't. Now you see it, now you don't. There it is, there it ain't. Here today, gone tomorrow. James says, that's your life. That's my life. It's a vapor. Here for a brief moment, and then it goes away. You know what? I bet what's true about my family is true about your family too. Death runs in my family. And you know, the reality is, it runs in all of our families. It runs in the one race, but we always want to fight for different races. It's called the human race. Death is coming. You know, I've been amazed at all my years, 20-something years of crisscrossing this country and preaching at a bunch of different places, of how many stories I get back from people that were there to hear me preach, but then they're gone 1 week to 2 weeks after I was there. I'm reminded of going to the Sun Dome in Tampa, Florida with Will's father, Billy Goodwin, a new song, and our big giant, you know, Winter Jam thing we did. 10,000 people in the building, and I preached the gospel. We had 1,000 people get saved. It was ridiculous. And later on that night, 3 hours after the concert, just three hours, Alex, Brandon, and Ashley, three teenagers, got in their car to go to Sonic because all their friends was going to meet at Sonic. And when they pulled out onto the highway, they were run over by a massive semi-truck. They're gone. Wow. I remember preaching in Toombs County, Georgia. They had a big outreach event, and so we met at a high school and had hundreds of people show up. It was awesome. I preached the gospel, and Jeff, there was a guy there that was about as big as you, brother. Maybe not as big, but he was almost there, brother. And he was in the back, and his name was Barry Benton. And I remember him because I gave the gospel, and he was one of the first people out to make his decision public. And he came out, and I remember him because he had a camo hat on, a camo bandana, camo shirt, camo pants, camo boots. I almost didn't see him, amen. I mean, he's just full of camo, just everywhere. And he come down, and he was pointing at me almost the whole time. And then when they went back to go with the counselors, he goes like that and pointed at me. And he was weeping, just weeping, big, brawly man. 1 week later, he was murdered in his sleep. Barry Benton. I remember another event I was preaching, and a little sweet girl named Ashley, she gave her life to Jesus, and then it wasn't very long after that that she was at Lake Lanier on Father's Day, and she got run over by another boat, died. How about this week, Wednesday? Is it Zeta? What was that big storm that went through? It went through Wednesday night, and in Buford, Georgia, a young couple, Grant and Mary Godby, went to sleep. They were in their bed, and a massive tree fell on them, and they died in their bed. 23 years old. Our life is a vapor. And you know one thing that's common about all those people? They never saw it coming. Never saw it coming. Our life is a vapor. I can go on and on and give you more and more stories, but I couldn't handle them emotionally. So let us just land here. Even if you live a ripe old age, it seems like time just flies by. I remember talking to my grandparents and then Tammy's grandparents, and they would always have this little phrase that they would say almost every time we were around them. Here was the little phrase. It seems like yesterday. That was their phrase. It seems like yesterday we were graduating from school in the 1950s. It seems like yesterday we got married. It seems like yesterday that we got those good jobs. It seems like yesterday that we had kids. It seems like yesterday our grandbabies were grandbabies. Now they're grand adults. It seems like yesterday. See, even if we live a ripe old age, time flies by because life is just a vapor. We have a limited life. In light of eternity, our life is just a psst. That's it. Here today, gone tomorrow. One of my favorite quotes of all time is by a preacher by the name of Louis Giglio. He's a friend of ours. And he made this comment one time. He said, life is short. Our time on earth is brief. So we best live for the stuff that lasts forever. You know what that is? That's called, you know, sometimes your front wheels can get out of alignment in your car. So you go get a front wheel alignment again. That's an alignment quote right there. Life is short. Our time on earth is brief. So we best live for the stuff that lasts forever. And James gives us the plan to do that. The problem that we face is a limited lens. We can't foresee the future. And then we have a limited life. Man, our life is a vapor. Here today, go tomorrow. And then he says, hey, here's a plan that we should follow. The plan that we should follow, submit to the Lord's will and serve the Lord's way. Simply, submit to the Lord's will. He said, instead you ought to say, if the Lord wills. Everybody say, if the Lord's will. 1, 2, 3.
If the Lord wills.
You did good. He said, you should say it. You just obeyed the Bible. Amen. You did it. Good job. He said, you should say, if the Lord's will. Now, for many believers, saying Lord willing is nothing more than a cliche. It's an obligatory statement that we superstitiously attach to our plans so that other people in the faith don't see us as presumptuous. Oh, if the Lord's wills. But that's not what James is saying. James is talking about a shifting, and it's an attitude toward life. It's a reorientation of you centering yourself in a very different way than you did before you met God. He's telling us that we are to submit ourselves to the God of the universe, because he's entitled to be the Lord of all things of our life, not merely a few things in our lives. Do you understand? If it's Lord but, it's Lord ain't. Because you can't have, you know, this, that, that's mine, this is his, that's mine, this is his, that's mine. No. Saying if the Lord wills means that we're humbly submitting ourselves before the one true God who's entitled to be the Lord over every area of our lives. And we must believe. You get there, you get to that place because you believe that God is involved in all of the details. Amen. I heard a story about this rich, old, mean atheist. He had ill will toward this older, sweet saint of God that was very impoverished. She lived in basically a shack, but she would often be seen on her front rickety porch just dancing and praising God and praying out loud. And he just didn't like her. And one day he's passing by, and he heard her on her porch praying for food. And so this atheist said, he goes to the grocery store and he bought 3 big bags of food, comes back to her house, places the food at the foot of her front door, and then he went and hid beside the side of her house. After a while, she came out. There was all the food. And she's just praising God. She got some food. She's just praising God for the provision. She's just clapping and dancing, praising God. At that atheist old codger jumped out from behind the house and landed on the porch and said, I gotcha. I bought you that food. That sweet senior adult looked at him. She goes, God brought me some food, and he used the devil's child to do it. Amen. That is a saint who believes that God is in the details. And it's easy to get to the place where we submit to his will when we're absolutely, completely convinced of that. So submit to the Lord's will. Do you know what? Any other way to live, he says, it's boasting, arrogance, and evil. Wow. Not including God. What is that? Well, you know, I prayed about this, but I didn't pray about that. Not that big of a deal. I considered God on this, but I didn't consider him on that. Not that big of a deal. No, arrogant, boasting, and evil. Halloween was yesterday. You know, for the past month, you probably have seen like a bunch of little decorations in people's lawns and have big old evil ghosts and ghoulish looking demons and zombies and all that stuff. And then last night, maybe you saw some zombie looking people and devil things on them and all that. And you think, whoa, that's evil. That demon thing, that's evil. Well, when God looks down from heaven, he may see something like that. But over here is a nice, sweet Christian in a nice little dress. And there's a nice little Christian guy, and he's in his little button up, it's been ironed, and there he is. But they're living their life without really considering God in the details. God looks at the zombie, and God looks at that little demon thing and goes, that ain't evil. That right there is evil. That right there, Mr. Button Up right there, who ain't considering me in his life, that's evil. Little sweet girl with a nice little purse and walking with a nice little dress and doing her thing, calling herself a Christian, but she's not considering me in life, evil. Wow. See, all the reasons for not living your life on your own, all the reasons for not being the God of your own life are summed up in that one word. Evil. It's evil. So we must submit to the Lord. And then when we do, we need to serve the Lord's way. Serve the Lord's way. He said this, it's interesting, the words that he uses. To him to know to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. That almost sounds like a Chinese fortune cookie, doesn't it? It's like, what was that? It's a strange arrangement of words again to me. Like last week we had some. What does he mean when he says that? Well, it's basically this. Know the right thing to do and then do the right thing. That's it. Know the right thing to do and then do the right thing. Jesus was our premier example of this. I love what he said in John 5:19. Whatever the Father does, the Son does likewise. That would be a definite shift in our orientation, wouldn't it? If we said, no, what do I want to do? Well, how does the Father want me to do it? How does the Son, who always follows the Father, how does he want me to do it? See, if you recall, this is an interesting deal, because what we need to do is we must know what good to do, and to do that, we have to look to God for that. Anytime you're looking for good, because see, sometimes we go, hey, I need to do the good thing. No, it might have too many zeros in it. G-O-O-D, take one of those O's out. You need the God thing to do, amen. Sometimes it might have a little too many zeros in it. You got to take one of those O's out and then go, I need the God thing to do. And then you do it. And listen, we release that control when we understand that God has a life for us that transcends our interests, our wants, our desires, our goals, our dreams, and our self-absorbed affection. God transcends that because God, listen to me, he has a plan for your life. God, I love the way the Apostle Paul put it in Ephesians 2:10. Listen to this. It says this, Ephesians 2:10. He said, we are his, God's, workmanship. That word means work of art. We are God's work of art. Look at the person next to you. Look at them in the face and say, I'm a work of art, baby. Go ahead and tell them. Somebody looking at you going, you certainly are. You are a work of art. You're a work of art. You are a work of art. He said, we were created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. See, you need to think of it this way. Our lives are blank canvas on which God wants to paint. Our lives is a blank canvas on which God wants to paint. And whenever we submit to the Lord's will, we're giving him the brushes. And whenever we serve the Lord's way, we're letting him pick the colors. And then when we give him the brushes by surrendering to the Lord's will and then serving the Lord's way, we let him pick the colors. Then we are essentially allowing God to paint a masterpiece of himself on to show the whole world that the tomb in Jerusalem is empty and the throne in heaven is occupied by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen. If there's one thing that America needs to see, whoever gets to be the president, one thing we can't lose as Christians is this fact. Our God will never be dethroned. Our God never has a 4-year limit. Our God is eternal and ruling and reigning. Our God is able. Our God is powerful. Our God is great. Somebody say amen. Amen. Our God is good. Our God doesn't change. Our God won't let us down. Amen. That's our God. So you know what we can do? We can serve him. We can say, okay, God, I'm releasing control. I'll surrender to your will. I'm going to give you the brushes. And God, I'm going to serve the Lord's way, and I'm going to let you pick the colors. God, during the season of my life, I sure hate these blues. I don't like all these blues. God, can I have some yellows, please? Boy, can I have some pastel colors? That would be so nice. It's a little bitty peppity. It's dark. But we have to understand that if God is using some dark colors, don't ever forget, it's necessary. Because remember, you're not painting a picture on the canvas of your life so you could show people how great you are. Nuh-uh. We surrender to this, and God is engaging in our life and on our lives. It's called a testimony. Amen. It's called a testimony. Individuals have it, churches have it. And then when you have this testimony, as you're living your life, as you're submitting to his will, as you're serving the Lord's way, and then all of a sudden this thing comes out of our life where now people are looking at us and it becomes overwhelmingly convincing. Wow, I guess the tomb is empty because I see God alive and well at Oakleaf. Amen. Well, I guess the throne in heaven is occupied because God's people are knocked back and set off the side by cultural changes. They're still full on and engaged and moving forward with hope and faith. Why? Because God's on his throne. Amen. So we submit to the Lord and we serve the Lord's way. And one thing we got to do, Don't limit yourself to living with just your limited lens. And don't limit yourself by living in just your limited life. I love this because this section of scripture is actually, to me, is an echo of Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. If you remember, probably about a month and a half ago, I preached a little series called A Powerful Problem-Solving Procedure. Try to say that fast, you'll hurt your lips. But and it was on Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Proverbs 3, 5 says, lean not on your own understanding. It's an intricate key that's crucial to solving issues in your life. Lean not on your understanding. What does that mean? Well, the word lean depicts an attitude of trust. So Solomon is saying, trust not. Trust not in what? Our own understanding. Very good. That's right. Own understanding. And what is understanding? Listen, understanding means this: your ability and my ability to know what is best for our lives minus the true God. In other words, your ability and my ability to know what is best for our lives minus prayer, minus godly counsel, minus Bible study, minus the one true God. And Solomon says, don't go there. And why? Why would he tell us not to lean into our own understanding? Why would he say that? Because listen, when we operate from what we think is best for our lives, we are prone to miss God's best for our life. When we operate from what we think is best about our lives, we are prone to miss God's best for our life. This is interesting because when we operate from our limited understanding of our circumstances, we fail to avail ourselves of God's unlimited understanding of our circumstances. Man, remember, we have a limited lens, but we serve a God who says, call unto me, and I will show you great and mighty things that you can't see on your own. He's an incredible God. So we'd be foolish not to tap in on that. When we do, we're limiting ourselves to our limited understanding of our circumstances. I was studying this, and then God brought something back to mind. I have one of my best friends. His name is Steve Whitcomb. He was the best man in my wedding. And he's pastoring a church in Jacksonville, Florida, called Promised Land Baptist Church. Great guy. He went to Montana to visit his sister, who was a missionary on the reservations out there for the Indians. And while he was there helping out and everything, he decided to do a little tourist thing, and he went to the battlefield of Little Bighorn. And when he was there, it blew my mind because you know about the Battle of Little Bighorn. It happened June 25th, 1876, and then what happened was is it was between Custer's 7th Cavalry Regiment of the United States Army against the Lakota, Cheyenne, and Arapaho tribes, right? And when you go to the battlefield today, there's these tombstones that are just checkered everywhere, not facing the same way like we do in our cemeteries, because what they did is they put the tombstones right where the bodies fell. And so there's almost 200 of them there. And about a mile away to the east, there's a lone tombstone. Let me tell you, I discovered the guy's name for that grave. It's Corporal John Foley of C Company. It is thought that he had been ordered to go get some backup. I think they needed it. And so after watching 100 men die horrible, brutal deaths from spears and arrows and hatchets, he jumped on his horse and he raced across the dry grassland to go summon the cavalry to help him. What's interesting is the story that the Indians tell of this man. He was chased for a mile by the Cheyenne Arapaho dog soldiers. Brutal, brutal. Racing, chasing him. They're throwing hatchets. They're throwing spears. They're shooting arrows. After about a mile, they were gaining on him. He abruptly stopped, turned toward them, stood in his stirrups, took his gun, and shot himself. Perhaps he didn't want to get murdered by them after all the carnage he saw on the battlefield. What he did not know is that those dog soldiers had just run out of arrows and all weapons, and they had just made the decision to let him go. Listen to me. Don't miss this. When we don't have the big picture, we are prone to make decisions that could be devastating to our lives. I'm gonna say it again. When we don't have the big picture, we are prone to make decisions that are devastating to our lives. But our God is a big picture God. And our God invites us into this relationship with him. The norm before was, do it on your own. I want to encourage you, don't do that. Stop doing that. Would you just let go? Don't be God. Don't be your own God. I told you last week, we make horrible gods. And I pointed at a lot of people in the audience and said, you make a bad God. Today I'm going, Tony Nolan, you are a horrible God. Well, I thought I'd hear my wife say amen, but she's just being sweet. She's over there being sweet. We're bad gods. We're not good at playing God. The best thing to do is to understand that the problem we face is we have a limited lens and a limited life. Therefore, our reach as gods, we're impotent. But if we tap into God, he's almighty. Amen. So we don't have to live in our limitations. We can tap into a God who is all-seeing, who says he can help us. And by the way, I think he's always looking to help us. And yeah, our life is a vapor, right? It doesn't have to be, because the Bible says you can have everlasting life. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I love the way that God stepped in on the scene. You know what he did? He busted through our limitations. And it's love. And why did he do that? Because he loves us so much, he wants to spend all of eternity with us. People we don't like spending a lot of time with, all right? God liked you so much, he wants to spend eternity with you. Isn't that glorious? Would you stand to your feet with me in this moment? Let's just stand. The other thing we've got to do, though, is serve the Lord's way, right? Serve the Lord's way. We have a plan to follow. Submit to the Lord's will and then serve the Lord's way. To get there, it takes release. And I've been in a lot of services before where we do things called invitations and we give people an opportunity to maybe walk down to the front and then connect with a counselor and have a moment with somebody. Those moments have been glorious and those moments are great. But I've learned over the years, I've lived long enough now to realize that nothing can substitute for the decision that you make in your heart. Not something that you just make in front of a bunch of people. It has to come from your heart. And when you get there at that place and you decide in your heart to release your interests, your wants, your desires, your goals, your dreams, your self-absorbed affections. See, never in the Bible will you ever hear God say, dream a dream. He says, exchange your dream for my life and my plan for you. Ephesians 2:10. You're mine, you're a work of art. And I've got a plan, I've got good works. Listen, I foreordained these works a long time ago. I've got plans I wrote out for you a long time ago. I'd love for you to connect with me, connect with those plans, and then live that out. Why? Again, not to show everybody how great you are, the car you drive, the house you live in, you know, the friends that you have, the clout that you have. None of that. That's not what it's about. Your life is a blank canvas on which God wants to paint a masterpiece of himself on to show the world how glorious he is, how awesome he is. Amen. And you know what? It doesn't require a lot of reaching and grabbing and scratching. All it requires is surrender. Surrender. And when we get there, man, we get an edge over our enemy. Those dog soldiers chased old corporate Foley down. But listen to me, you got somebody worse than the dog soldiers chasing you down. Satan is seeking whom he may devour. When you woke up this morning, he's in hot pursuit for you. And he's got maybe not a hatchet, maybe not, an arrow with a flint on it or spear. The Bible says in Ephesians, he has fiery darts. That's an interesting terminology, isn't it? In other words, listen, he's got weapons that he formed against you. and he's going to toss them at you. And what we don't need to do, no matter what happens in a vote, no matter what happens in our America, no matter what happens in our society, no matter how dark it gets, no matter how crazy it might get, because if you think that the guy that you're voting for this week and he becomes the president, you think that everything's great, hold on, don't forget, Satan is still out there and he's still got his fiery darts. And listen, you're not voting for president, you're voting for president, you're not voting for God, amen. God don't require a vote. He's God, amen. He's the God of the universe. And if Satan comes after you and he throws those fiery darts, guess who he's got to go through? He's got to go through God. Do you remember the message that Pastor Will preached not too long ago? Whenever you surrender to God and you submit to God, and then the devil has to flee from you. Remember that? He's got to flee from you. Why? Because when you're God's, God takes up for you. Amen. God said, hey, you can't get to this one because that one's mine. And I love the way Will put it. He's got to go, I'm out. I can't win this one. Amen. He can't win it. Lord, we thank you for your word, God. We make horrible gods, and we're sorry for the moments that we tried to push you off the throne of our heart. God, today we take this moment as we're about to sing. And God, as we sing, inside our hearts, we want to do the exercise of releasing and surrender and placing you back on your rightful place on the throne of our hearts. And God, as we leave, may we live in such a way that when the world looks at us, they'll see a canvas with a masterpiece of you on it. And we can declare, our God is great. The tomb in Jerusalem is empty, and the throne in heaven is occupied by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And you are never shaken. You are always constant. You are all powerful. And you love us. And for that, we say, thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.